and task force, and many thanks to you for creating this, all of the leadership, Representative Arasimowitz and Representative Cafaro. I'd like to start off with a few thank yous. Thank you to Senator Toni Harp. She was absolutely wonderful to work with, very thoughtful and highly knowledgeable, and just a joy. And I think we did accomplish what we set out to accomplish. I'd also like to thank the legislative staff that supported our work. In an already busy legislative session, they absolutely dropped everything when we needed them. Jason Stark of House Republicans, Kara Passero of House Democrats, Katie Duggan of Senate Democrats, and Mike Goodwine of the Senate Republicans. I'd also like to thank Marilyn Giuliano and Deborah Lee Hovey for their special expertise in the school mental health situations and how the schools deliver their services. That was very helpful. So on to the bill. This deals with sections 64 to 69. There were four consensus items, and the first one is regarding mental health first aid. And the overriding theme of our working group was the effort and the importance of destigmatizing mental illness. It still is a frontier that hasn't been addressed, and it's still something we don't want to talk about, and we need to talk. This is the opportunity to make it important and start talking about it. What the first section deals with is requiring Department of Mental Health and Addiction Services, otherwise known as DMHAS, and State Department of Education, SDE, to create a program that trains people in recognizing the signs of mental disorders in children and young adults and connects children and young adults showing signs of mental disorders with an appropriate professional. This is what mental first aid training is. And I did, just a quick sidebar, I did take the training a month ago in Shelton at the Recovery Networks program, and I can't stress enough how important it is for everyone to take it. It's a 12-hour course. I already had a good, solid working knowledge of mental health issues and behavioral health issues, and I learned a tremendous amount, and I think it's really incumbent on all of us to lead in this and take the course. We will be offering it here at some point, probably this summer. The second part of this consensus item number one is includes a program in list of items for SDE to assist and encourage local school districts to include the mental health first aid training in their in-service days. May I sidebar for a few of this, or should I? Yes.
Absolutely.
Okay. We had three kids that went through public school, and there were issues, and I have many friends whose kids also went through the school system, and there are some simple anxiety issues that if the kids are dealt with early, they don't grow into anger and frustration issues. So I think I can't stress the importance of this, of early identification and intervention. The third part under consensus item one is that requires the Commissioner of Education to consider if programs should be required in teacher prep work for professional certification. So this would be, I hope, mandated for any future teachers to learn, to take the mental first aid training and learn more about it. The consensus item number two is section 66, and this deals with the task force. Which would report back February 1st of 2014 in time for the next legislative session. There were seven topics, consensus topics, that the mental health working group would deal with. I'll just read a couple of them. Improving behavioral health screening, closing gaps in private insurance coverage. We did hear a lot of that in the 12-hour public hearing, that mental health parity is much needed, and there are tremendous gaps in the service. Addressing the insufficient number of certain behavioral health providers. I know our state is lacking in child psychiatrists, so what we might be able to do to train them and attract them and keep them here would be important. Two additional school security ideas were to provide intense, under the mental health task force, would be to provide intensive individualized behavioral health intervention services in schools for students exhibiting violent tendencies. Second part of this is to require State Department of Education to provide technical assistance to school districts concerning behavioral health intervention specialists. The consensus item number three, I'm sorry, there were a few other non-consensus items under the task force, and some of these were involuntary commitment, outpatient involuntary commitment, also duty to report, which we felt certainly had a great deal of merit, but it was too short a timeline to do it in this period of time, but it should absolutely be looked at more in depth. Possible behavioral health screenings of public school children, requiring disclosure of communications by mental health professionals, that's the duty to report, which New York State I know is having difficulty now enforcing it, and it's a very difficult issue and again requires a lot of in-depth discussion and research. Consensus item, and the mental health task force would be 20 voting members. Consensus item number three, regards direct service providers. DMIS would expand the assertive community treatment, which is ACT, teams to three cities that do not currently have the program. The assertive community treatment program is a recovery-oriented mental health service delivery model which focuses on fostering an individual's ability to live in the community through psychosocial rehabilitation. And these are the more difficult and challenging forms of mental illness. ACT teams treat persons with severe and persistent mental illness who live with serious impairments that hinder their ability to seek treatment autonomously. Services are delivered by multidisciplinary health staffs who work in mobile teams to help clients achieve self-sufficiency and increased quality of life. Services are tailored to the individual and are provided continuously with no set time frame in order to ensure continuity of caregiving. Very important effort, and it's great success, the people that are getting this treatment. A couple of the other treatments are Melissa's Project. Section 68 is required DMIS to provide case management and coordination for people with mental illness who are not involved in the probate court system. This is based on Melissa's Project, and Melissa's Project is a guardian ad litem services core program. It's been very successful in the Valley area, and it's based on the guardian model of mental health care management established in 2002. Their mission is to be an innovator in the effort to empower people with mental illness who receive services to act as partners with providers, policymakers, and family members or guardians and ensure that services meet their expressed needs and wishes and improve overall care in the public mental health care system. The last consensus item is number four, which is section 69 in the bill, and it establishes Access Mental Health. And this is the Connecticut version of the Psychiatry Access Project, modeled after a very successful Massachusetts program. Access Mental Health is, the goal is to ensure that all youth in Connecticut have child psychiatry and behavioral health services that are accessible through their primary care providers. Access Mental Health will provide primary care providers with timely access to child psychiatry consultation and, when indicated, care coordination and transitional services into ongoing behavioral care. I just wanted to add a few notes, a few thoughts of my own on this. Again, this was a very, I think, one of the most important parts of this bill. When I first heard about this shooting in Sandy Hook, and I think all of us, it's right up there with knowing where we were when we heard about 9/11, I think every one of us forever will remember where we were. It's just, you don't forget it. We can make more restrictive gun laws, but that's not going to prevent future Sandy Hook or Aurora, Colorado's from happening without major changes in our mental health care and behavioral health care system. And I think we're kidding ourselves if we don't consider this pretty seriously. And I find it illogical and quite frankly offensive that some see mental health efforts as a red herring against efforts to increase gun control. I heard that from a number of people, and I thought, somebody's out there spinning it. And that's just totally false. The common denominator in all these mass shootings was the mental health and emotional instability of these perpetrators. Had they not had access to guns, they possibly would have found other means to inflict destruction. As a society, we cannot continue to underserve or ignore mental health and behavioral issues. They are at the core of so much of the violence that occurs in our world today. We have the responsibility to learn more, lead more as legislators, and educate our citizens about mental health issues and effectively address them, mental health and behavioral issues, and address them. In closing, I'd like to share Nelba Marquez Green's testimony at the mental health public hearing on January 30th. Ms. Marquez Green is a licensed marriage and family therapist whose daughter, Anna Grace, died in Sandy Hook School. There were three key points to her testimony: the need to destigmatize mental health and increase access to treatment. And this is a woman who wrote this a month after her daughter died. She was very clear on what was important. Identify gaps in the state's current mental health system. Implement new family-strengthening programs while enriching existing ones. It's pretty compelling to hear that. Let's take this opportunity to learn more about mental health and behavioral health care issues and address it. This is an important issue. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, Representative Wood. Recognize Representative Magnin.